Let me call us to order and invite you to join us for our Tuesday, May 10th Economic Development Committee meeting. My honor to be joined by my colleagues, Marquise Harris Dawson, Nuri Martinez, and Paul Kikorian. And together, we are here to go over an exciting agenda. We invite your participation, involvement, and rapt attention, please. We will open the floor for public comment, and having no cards, we will close the public comment without objection. Members, without objection, we'll take items 1 through 4 on consent, unless there's a burning desire to do otherwise. I will accept the motion by Councilmember Martinez. And with that, Mr. Clerk, item 5.
Item number 5 is an Economic and Workforce Development Department report relative to the authorization to accept $2.4 million in Los Angeles County Youth Jobs Program funds for implementation of youth work experience programs.
Okay. No surprise to you that the summer jobs are very important in each of our districts. We've already been getting calls, a lot of interest. Every place I go, people want to know how many jobs they're going to be, how they sign up, where they need to qualify. And so we hope to get those answers from you and more.
Good afternoon. Jaime Pacheco Orozco, Economic and Workforce Development Department.
Nancy Herrera, Economic and Workforce Development Department. In terms of the questions about what's coming up for the summer, we have yet to get an allocation from the County of Los Angeles. We do know that there's one coming, but their focus really is on the April-June program right now. Traditionally, they're giving us about $5 million to begin the program, beginning meaning the summer months.
And what is that? What's that date?
July 1 through... They make it a year-round contract, actually. They recently extended it. Previously, they used to end it on December 31st. But because for the past 2 years, there's been a trend of having additional monies available in the springtime of next year, for example, spring 2017. Last year, they decided to make it a year-long contract. However, the funding comes in allocations. So the initial allocation, we're anticipating just over $5 million, and that would cover traditionally the July 1 to October 31st period. And then we would anticipate getting additional funds that would cover, again, the April to June 2017 period.
Okay, anything else?
So the item you have before you is the second allocation of funds from this current year's award of $8 million. This item was previously brought to City Council and the Board for approval. We are making recommendations on the $2.4 million to allocate them to various agencies. It's attachment A in the back of the report is where the allocations will go for the individual agencies.
So let's talk about the method used to distribute funds. You know, look at this chart. I'm certainly pleased to see that that the allocation of funds going into the South area, with the number of jobs, but I'm sure my colleagues are concerned and wondering why not a different kind of allocation. Can you give us some detail on what went into that?
We use the currently available poverty data for the planning areas to decide what the percentage of the total number of available jobs will be. And that's how it's distributed amongst the planning areas. Within the planning areas, we have, depending upon the density of the population and the percentage of poverty, we'll have one or more program operators in the area. The allocation to the individual agencies is based on their requests and the number of slots available. So it has to do both with their capacity and their request.
So what kind of requests do you get? Does that want 10 jobs or I got 5 slots? What do they ask?
We give them an intent to participate. We tell them what the qualifications are because they vary The eligibility during the summer may vary from the eligibility during April and June.
Okay, let's talk about the summer. What kind of eligibility are we talking about
for
summer
the county
jobs?
Funds, it's divided amongst youth who are receiving CalWORKs, youth who are in a category that used to be termed net county costs, which basically is county general fund, which is for low-income youth in general, and then foster youth. The county makes the decision as to what the percentage of distribution will be of those funds. So every contractor who applies knows that they will take a portion of each because, quite frankly, it's more difficult to recruit the CalWORKs youth and the foster youth. Everyone would love to have the net county cost, which is just low income, but everybody takes a portion of each funding stream. So the agency itself presents its request based on what its assessed capacity is, and also if they have any residual slots that they have available from the summertime, because they can continue to fill those until they exhaust the originally allocated funds.
So are these slots normally filled, or do you...
They are normally filled.
Month in, you sort of readjust and reallocate, or...
We adjust and reallocate because attendance is not perfect among youth who are working. So every youth starts out with an allocation of 120 hours. However, some don't, for a variety of reasons, some don't complete all the hours, in which case the contractors look at both the number of slots that they filled as well as any unexpended funds and pool those again to see whether they can enroll more youth or whether they can give existing youth additional hours.
And how many hours are they working a day and how much are they earning?
It varies. Some work sites have a need for a longer day. For example, a daycare may require 8 hours a day, whereas an office might require 4 to 5 hours a day. In total, the youth receive 120 hours, which includes 20 hours of personal enrichment training, which is job readiness, as well as financial literacy.
Members?
Do you have a breakdown of participants, male versus females?
When we did the tally for the summer, we had approximately 58% female and the balance male.
Is that every year or is that just recent data?
It traditionally runs a little higher on females than on male.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I just want to see a concentrated effort to serve young women. Historically, women step up to take responsibility and take care of their families sometimes. I just want to make sure that these programs are geared towards young women who will find themselves in this situation so they're not going off finding other ways to make ends meet. So.
Sure.
Did you say how much they're earning? Well, you said it varies, right? So what kind of range?
Last summer they were earning $9 an hour. Currently they would be paid $10 an hour. In July 1 they'll be paid $10.50 an hour.
Part of the story here in South is that 190 jobs are going to the school district. So how does that work?
That's because LAUSD is participating in a special project. South LA Scholars, working in conjunction with four South LA area high schools, they're working with Los Angeles Trade Tech College on a specific project. That's why they got a lion's share of jobs, because they specifically are running that program.
And how about homeless youth? How do we identify them, or how do we serve them?
Homeless youth during the summer, as opposed to the year-round programming, is self-declared. We did run a report on the number of homeless youth that we had in the system. In total, we had 149 homeless youth who were self-reported. Among youth, often it's not reported homeless because you have a lot of couch surfing.
Right.
And they may not consider themselves homeless. And it is self-reported. They also don't have to check any of the boxes. It's not required for them to qualify. So quite often young people will not check probation, will not check homeless, will not check foster even.
But they could be qualified otherwise, correct?
They'll qualify anyway, correct. This is just additional demographic data, and often it goes unchecked.
Talk a little bit about the agencies that were selected to provide these services. It looks like an interesting cross-section, but are they selected because they
the qualifying...
Offering something special, or they just put the request in first, or how are they selected, and more importantly, how are they evaluated?
The qualifying agencies are made up of the year-round youth floor centers. All of them qualify to be summer program operators because they are operating...
So they're operating youth centers now?
Correct.
All of them, most of them, some of them?
The majority.
Majority, okay.
The balance were procured through an RFQ, a request for qualifications, that was part of a youth system support RFQ, and we had all of the service elements that are involved in the year-round federally funded program. Specifically, we asked about summer program operations, so they did have to respond. That put them on a qualified list, and anyone who was on the qualified list was sent information and the intent to participate in the program. So they were procured through an RFQ if they aren't already youth force centers.
So if you want to be joined by Councilman Cedillo. So if an office wanted to make sure that youth in their area were being serviced, we need to look at these organizations and make sure they're doing some outreach or they've got a plan or what's
correct.
What's
and for step? The summer, we also have the HireLAsYouth.org website. Because we have so many more requests for jobs than jobs are available, we use a lottery system.
Right.
That opened on May 4th, and as of today, we had about 3,500 registrations.
Now, the mayor made a pledge during his State of the City, I think, that every student who wanted a job would get a job. Was he exaggerating? Did I overhear something? Or
I couldn't comment on what the mayor said, so I do apologize. But we are limited by the resources that are available. We generally have more individuals applying for jobs than we have the capacity to serve.
So is there another pot then aside from these $1,100, these 1,100 jobs with this $22.4 million? Is there another pot of job money around?
So there is. This is part of an $8 million award that the county provided the city. So this is the second allocation from the county. In addition to that, we do have the general fund dollars available for summer youth employment as well. They come to the regular budget process.
And how do citizens access that pot?
Excuse me,
how do they access that pot of money?
It's a lottery system. Folks,
oh, is that the lottery you're speaking of?
Right. We do also have the potential for another $300,000 from the county for the current April to June period. The county has gone through a couple of iterations as to how to they want to distribute the funds, so I'm standing at the front of the line with my hand out.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chair. Just following up on the question about homeless youth, I think it's exactly right. Young people don't volunteer their homeless status, even if they're asked directly, understandably. But there are other categories that seem more clear, like foster care. So I'm wondering, do you all have a goal as it relates to foster care, or do the work source centers have a set targeting of foster youth? And then the second question I have is, do you all know the extent to which background is going to matter? So if a teen has been arrested or expelled from school or something like that, will their backgrounds be looked at before they're able to qualify for these types of
jobs? Yeah, would it prevent them from being eligible?
In terms of the backgrounds, there are some positions, primarily within the county, that do require a live scan. I don't believe it captures whether or not they've been expelled from school. It would just capture any sort of involvement with the juvenile justice system. Certainly, the majority of jobs do not require a background check. It's in certain situations. We have, for example, UCLA is planning to utilize its UniCamp. And those youth would require a background check because they will be working with children. So it's in specific situations. In regard to the foster youth, we work very closely with the Opportunity Youth Collaborative because we have been working for the past 3 years to increase the direct pipeline between the foster youth and the job availability. One of the challenges has been that June traditionally is the time at which they decide to transfer youth to other locations because the school year is over. So we're continuing. In fact, we're right in the midst of coming up with what we feel is the best design in order to meet that challenge and work collectively to outreach to more foster youth.
Mr. Gregorian?
Every year, this is every council member's, I think, favorite program. We all realize the extraordinary value that there is in employing young people, and it's one thing that I wish we could do a lot more of and add a lot of resources to. That being said, I'm sure it's out there, and it just hasn't come across my desk. I don't recall ever really seeing any kind of metrics for long-term success to demonstrate, you know, program participants stayed throughout the program X percentage of time with this provider. 5 years later, after graduation, program participants, you know, were not involved in crime, maintained full-time employment, et cetera, et cetera. There's a lot of sort of longitudinal measures that we could have that would demonstrate this provider's doing it really well, this provider's maybe not doing it as well. There are certain best practices that we could, you know, take to the next level in order to build the program to even greater success. Is there, you know, sort of retrospective evaluation like that that's ever done that we can learn from?
We have we've contracted with CSUN to look at the performance of our various youth programs. And so part of the allocation you'll notice here, we do have some money set aside for an evaluation of the program.
Great.
And so we do look at the outcome side of it and the satisfaction side of it. The long-term longitudinal piece is a little more difficult just simply because of the data is collected and how we validate the data. A good portion of it comes through our own data collection system, and the state has gone through various iterations on that state on the data collection system. But we can look at that. We can meet with your staff to see how we can explore that at greater length and in greater depth.
Yeah, because I'm quite confident that even the moderately successful programs would demonstrate such an extraordinary cost effectiveness and return on investment that, you know, there will be a case that will be made to both the philanthropic community and to taxpayers that this is money very, very well invested. But you got to kind of show it to them. You got to demonstrate it. And then in terms of the allocation among the geographical allocation, since it's based on these factors of TANF receipt and foster youth status and low-income youth, it would be useful, I think, to have the region, have that information provided for each of the regions as well, so that we can see that, you know, so that we can see how that is reflected in the allocation of the jobs.
Sure.
I just, you know, back of the envelope, it looks like the Valley has about 25% of the jobs. We have about 40 or 45% of the population, but I have no idea what the percentages would be of TANF eligibility and these other factors unless you really see it laid out. So I don't necessarily need to report back on that, but if you could just provide that, I would be interested to see that. And then, you know, again, just to reiterate, if there are best practices that, you know, you've seen in evaluating this that we can build upon or provide as benchmarks for the less well-performing programs, I'd be very interested in pursuing that as well.
During the summer, we do monitor each site, and we have an orientation for all the contractors at the beginning of the year, and we also have a debrief at the end. And that really is the purpose, to find out what the challenges were, how we can address them, capture all the best practices so that we can put out a better product each year and have it continuously improve. In terms of the work experience, there is a professor from Drexel, Paul Harrington. In fact, he'll be coming out in a couple of weeks. He always presents a very palatable and a very engaging data about work and work experience and the job market for youth. And he has an overarching report that talks about the importance of early work experience for young people and the financial impact it can even have on their future earnings. So you're absolutely right. Even if it's relatively short, even if it was maybe a 6 out of 10 in terms of their attendance, or even a 10 out of a 10. They do absolutely come away with something.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's critical.
And then several of my colleagues also mentioned this, the idea of how do we ensure that we're really targeting the right youth when a lot of this is based on self-reporting of status. Is there a way that LAUSD could be helpful in that LAUSD keeps statistics on homeless students, on free and reduced eligibility, on foster status, and a number of these other categories that would be highly relevant to this? They have that. So we wouldn't need to rely on self-reporting if we could rely on, say, referrals. I'm sure they wouldn't share that personal information with us, but if they gave us a list of people that they've already screened as being eligible, that would be one way that we would know that we have an appropriately targeted population.
It's probably better done as an outreach effort on part of LAUSD, simply because there is confidential information that they cannot share. But rather than providing us with a list of names of eligible folks, it's really more focusing on their outreach efforts to this particular population.
Yeah. Yeah, even if it's just outreach, that would be helpful.
Sure.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
And is this funding amount larger than last year, about the same? And the number of jobs are pretty consistent over the several years? Are we seeing a nice uptick, or where are we with the terms
We've
of total?
Had an increase for about the last 3 years. Summer 15 was larger than summer 14. Summer 16, at least at present, looks about on an even playing with summer 15, but we don't have the official allocation yet. But it should be about $5.2 million for the summer.
Okay. Members, any other questions? Okay, thank you. Thank you for the report. We're excited about this program. It's one that our constituents are asking about and one that our students need. Yeah, students and families benefit certainly from this. We've got one card on this item, Mr. Howland. No? Excuse me. Oh, that's item 7. Okay. So there's then we will approve the, without objection, we'll approve the EWDD report on summer youth employment. Okay, that will be the order. Item 6, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 6 is a CLA report in response to motion Wesson Price relative to instructing the CLA and the CAO to report on the current regulatory code as it pertains to business development, recruitment, and retention in the City of Los Angeles and related matters. This item was noted and filed by the Ad Hoc Committee on Comprehensive Job Creation Plan on April 19, 2016.
Okay, we did have the pleasure of hearing this report, I think, earlier as reported. So please refresh our memory and provide us with an update.
Good afternoon, council members. My name is Steve Liu with the Office of the CLA. The report presented before you today is in response to motion Wesson Price, and we'll begin to respond to the portion of the motion that addresses the review of regulatory codes. In order to begin to address this motion, our office found it useful to study the regulatory environments of other municipalities in order to get a sense of where the City of Los Angeles ranks relative to other cities. As a result, this report highlights key findings from the U.S. Chamber of Commerce Foundation's Regulatory Climate Index from 2014. The Regulatory Climate Index assesses 5 areas of business regulation and the impacts that they typically have on small businesses within 10 cities. For the purposes of this report, 5 cities were chosen: Dallas, Raleigh, Los Angeles, San Francisco, and New York City. Although each of these cities are distinct within their own regards, i.e. population, per capita income, number of businesses, and overall geography, they were sampled from the Regulatory Climate Index to represent a wide range of economic and demographic backgrounds of small and large cities across the nation. Of the 5 cities sampled for our report, the City of Los Angeles ranks lower than Raleigh and Dallas and higher than San Francisco and New York City. The index assesses a city by first calculating a score for each area of business regulation based upon the simple average of 3 factors that measure regulatory burden: the number of procedures, the time to comply with a requirement, and the costs and fees associated. As outlined by the index, the five areas of business regulation are as follows and are used for the rankings. The first is starting a business, which would involve reserving a company name, incorporating a company, registering as an employer, or attaining the appropriate licenses for a business. The second is the processing of construction permits, which involves the attainment of appropriate permits to build small commercial buildings and zoning and environmental review. The third is the registration of property, which applies to businesses that undergo commercial building transactions, and if applicable, includes payments of real estate transfer taxes, real property tax, and real property taxes. The fourth is the payment of taxes, and this speaks for itself and includes the payment of such taxes as sales taxes, employment taxes, corporate taxes, and income taxes. The last is the enforcement of contracts, which is the assurance and protection of business agreements between multiple parties. Taking these scoring indices into account, out of the 10 cities that were evaluated in the Regulatory Climate Index, the City of Los Angeles ranked as follows during 2014. The overall ranking of the city was 8th out of 10. The ranking for the city in starting a business was first, where we were tied with the City of San Francisco due to our low costs and procedures and our minimal waiting time. The second is the processing of construction permits, which is 7th due to our high costs. The third is the registration of property, where we are also 7th due to our high waiting time and costs. The fourth is the payment of taxes, where we are last due to our high corporate tax and regulations. The fifth is the enforcement of contracts, where we are 8th. It should be noted that these rankings were based on the regulatory climate in 2014 and that these rankings and the respective regulations may have changed. We utilized this index for a report because we found it to be a good indicator. It takes into account barriers to entry that represent the life cycle of a small business and provides a useful snapshot for comparison with the City of Los Angeles. In addition, it is also important to note that the scoring of several of these areas of business regulation are affected by state regulation, i.e. CEQA reform and state taxes. In order to help remedy these issues, the city can seek to pursue state legislation or administrative action that may help alleviate some of this regulation. As this is an initial study in the review of regulatory codes, our subsequent reports will take into account this index and other studies as well as updates to information as they become available. Thank you.
Okay, members, any questions?
I have a few questions. Why did you look at five municipalities instead of the 10 that were in the original study?
Well, we chose to look at five cities because I wanted to condense this report since it was a summary of the overall report.
So that was your call?
It was an evaluation based on our office.
Okay.
And in addition, we decided to choose two cities that ranked higher than the City of Los Angeles, and the two cities that were chosen to be worse were the only two cities that were below us.
So among the five, we rank in the middle. Where would we have ranked had we compared ourselves to the 10 in the original study?
In the original study, we were ranked 8th.
Okay. And for our regulatory environment, it seems like we're doing really good, like you stated, in starting businesses, and we sort of ruin it by selling everything else from the permits to the contract enforcement piece. So is the CLA's office going to study this and make recommendations on how we fix this moving forward after?
We could further evaluate this for our subsequent reports as we continue to address the remainder of the motion.
You're going
to
do what?
We could further investigate this as we address the remainder of the motion.
Well, I think we need to be very clear. What are we getting out of this? For the future, we need to certainly provide with recommendations on how we improve the way we do business in the city, or else I'm not sure why we even looked at the city to begin with.
Yeah, John Wickham with the CLA's office. Yes, we could absolutely, your instruction, continue to look at this. As Mr. Liu mentioned, a lot of the factors relate to state law or county administrative action. So what we can do is actually look at those and see whether there's legislative action we could recommend to help alleviate that. We may have ideas for you to go to the state legislature, the county, and say, hey, you know, look, we need to address this issue. This is affecting business in the City of Los Angeles.
Okay, so can we bring that back?
Absolutely.
Are we moving forward? All right. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Anything else? Okay, we're going to then concur with the ad hoc committee and ask that you come back here to address those issues that have been raised by Councilwoman Martinez and for any further questions that may occur.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Members, earlier we, on consent, approved the appointment of members to the Industrial Development Authority. One such member is with us, Mr. Raymond Bishop, and we want to give Mr. Bishop an opportunity to come forward and just say a few words. Thank you for your service and for your willingness to serve on yet another city commission.
Thank you so much, honorable council members. I am honored to have the opportunity to come before you once again. My first commission with the city was under Mayor Bradley, and I've served on a number of commissions, and I look forward to my service, and I especially appreciate seeing how you work together to take care of the city's business in such a great way. I learned from that, and I hope that,
a little closer.
And I hope that that learning experience will carry on to the commissions that I continue to serve on in the future. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Bishop, for your service and for your willingness to continue serving.
Thank you. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, sir. Okay, Mr. Clerk, what's the next item before us?
Item number
next
seven.
And the last item before us.
Item number seven is an EWDD and joint CAO CLA reports relative to efforts to create a citywide economic development plan.
Okay, well, we invite CLA and the CAO. Table, please.
Good afternoon. Dora Huerta with the Office of the Chief Legislative Analyst.
And Shafi Amir from the Office of the CAO.
The report before you responds to a motion we saw at CEDIO and a number of subsequent committee instructions, including instructions from this committee, directing our offices to report on EWDD's efforts to create and implement a citywide economic development strategy. Specifically, the report's recommendations include authorizing the general manager of EWDD to prepare a request for proposals for the selection of a consultant to prepare the citywide economic development strategy and report back to council with that request for proposals. And instruct EWDD to work with other departments to develop a scope of work for that RFP relative to the economic development strategy. Our offices were asked to review a number of reports by EWDD, including, but the reports included various work program and departmental goals. We recommend that those goals be further considered in formulating a larger comprehensive strategy that would be formed with interdepartmental coordination and local stakeholder input.
And our office, the CAO, has preliminarily identified available funding in the unappropriated balance line item in the current fiscal year called Economic Development Initiative, which is comprised right now of $1.5 million. This could be a potential source of funding for the consultant costs for EWDD. That line item in the UB is subject to review for reappropriation in the 15-16 year-end FSR, which is forthcoming. In any case, once the department comes forward with their draft RFP and so forth back to council and mayor, our office, the CAO, would anticipate identifying a funding source for them to use for the consultant costs. And so if you have any questions, we're here to answer them.
Members, any questions? Well,
I just want to offer one suggestion. I just want to make sure that the RFP includes language that states that the city is also looking at how the strategy is tailored to benefit all parts of our city and to ensure that the broader strategy is not at the expense of individual communities, like the ones I represent in the Valley. Okay. Mm-hmm.
And I'd just like to add that that you report back to this committee before you go to mayor and council, but you come back to this committee and let us know what's up.
To include that language as well.
Yeah, sure.
Absolutely. Mr. Dawson.
Could you just take a quick second to talk about the scope of work for the consultant that you're hiring out? I'm just not super clear on what kind of firm we're hiring and what we're asking them to do.
Sure. We're seeking a consultant that will prepare a citywide strategy with a shared vision. They'll be working with EWDD to facilitate stakeholder input departmental coordination, working with the various departments, because we recognize that several departments also play a role in facilitating or promoting economic development. Looking at other strategies that the city is considering right now, such as EIFDs and CREAs, and bringing all of those together to lay out some comprehensive goals and objectives for the city. Some of the elements that we think are important in the strategy that we'd like the consultant to consider are looking at the economic development chapter that already exists in our general plan, setting regional conditions. The county recently released their economic development strategy for the next few years as well, and a number of mayoral and council initiatives that we've recently been studying. And then also laying out some metrics and indicators that would track the strategy's progress.
Thank you.
Any other comments?
I just, quick question. We don't have any insight, in your department, there's no one that can tell us how to do that. We have to hire a consultant to do that.
Yeah.
There's no one in the city that can tell us how to come up with the city's economic development plan.
Yeah. I guess to add to Councilwoman Martinez's point, it did not seem like there was a special set of tasks in there that would require the expertise of an outside. I mean, because it sounds like resident engagement, engagement of general managers, and a review of our existing policies and initiatives. I feel like those are the three categories I heard. So I'm just wondering, what does the firm bring that makes us have to seek them out?
You can go. I'll go second.
If it's that people don't have time, then that's fine too. I'm genuinely curious.
To speak to the first piece, so it's EWDD.
It's right there, the Job Creation Committee that Mr. Kaporian chairs. I mean, there's got to be another way. We used to have a CRA once upon a time.
I think to speak to, and I'll let the CLA's office also answer on that respect, what's laid out in the report before you is incorporating much of what Ad Hoc Jobs has been covering as far as bringing it together in one comprehensive plan together. And obviously they would work, EWDD has been the department to report back on that and has been reporting back on economic development strategies. Regarding staffing and the use of a consultant, they are not necessarily equipped to look at it comprehensively, and that's why there has been that allowance made so that they may need to retain a consultant for this. I mean, it's something for them to develop a scope of work and assess, you know, and more than likely we took the step of ahead of time identifying potential consultant costs for them should they need to hire a consultant in order to assist them. I don't know if you wanted to add.
I think it's the expectation that the department will work very closely with the consultant.
I just feel like
to guide a lot of that work.
There's got to be a study that we probably commissioned a couple of years ago. How much is this going to cost? How much are you looking at? What is this RFP?
We don't know yet.
We think the scope of work will determine.
Right?
$1 million to pay for the study?
Did you say a million from which
we haven't? We haven't identified a cost yet. This was just the line item that currently exists in the UB. We don't, we haven't said that it would cost that amount. Pardon?
A million sounds about right. Since I've been here, that's more or less.
I mean, that would be something that they would need to report back on. It wouldn't necessarily, be the full amount.
We typically wouldn't put an amount in the contract because we wouldn't want people to be driving a plan at $1 million, right? So the intent would be to try and constrain that a little bit. In the past, the city has typically hired consultants to put some of these things together because they are big picture, and most of the staff in the departments are focused on individual programs. The Economic Development Department in particular has very limited staff, and their staff by source of funding are very restricted in their ability to do broad general tasks like this. So since they don't have a lot of general fund money, they may not be able to find staff who would be able to focus on a on a general project like this. And one of the things that we're looking at is ensuring that we create a tool here that can be used not only for the general city planning purpose, but also to address federal grant funding programs as well, because there are certain grant funding programs that require that we have an economic development plan in place. And so this would be structured in a way that lets us not only tackle our own individual or our own city needs, but also our federal needs.
Thank you.
Senator?
I want to follow up on Ms. Martinez's questions and ask that, let me make this work here. We focus on tax policy, obviously, I thought that was in there, that we focus on. So one thing that's very well articulated lately is this growing divide between wealth and poverty in the nation and in our city, and so that we look at how we bridge that. So what are the strategies, what are the jobs that we should be looking to create? Obviously, we have two great schools, UCLA and USC, that have great business departments and do these forecasts and do these studies, but what are the things that we should be doing? Where should we be kind of creating these jobs? Who are we and how are we educating people to prepare for these jobs? And so that we're not just chasing trends, but actually trying to grab a control of the certain assets that the city has, you know, location, quality education, you know, abundance of educational institutions in the area, our infrastructure, and what are the things that we can do to buttress those things. What comes to mind immediately is the proposals for, is it R2? And the amount of jobs that could be created with that and the investments that would be involved in terms of that type of infrastructure. I recently entertained a proposal around us enhancing our capacity at the ports and what are the things that down in that area that we could do that would enhance our capacity and create jobs and economic activity. But I think the real concern, I know Ms. Martinez was articulating it, is this making sure that we all boats rise and that there's a lot of boats that are at the bottom. There's incredible wealth in this region, the city, and yet there's incredible density and poverty exists. And so that this creation of jobs should also be looking at, you know, our housing stock, our educational institutions, our healthcare institutions, the things that are part of creating a community, and finally, our public space and types of investments that we could be making in that public infrastructure, from parks and, you know, museums, concert halls, recreation centers, et cetera.
And so these would be areas that the committee would like us to incorporate into the scope of work for the analysis by the consultant.
I would.
And I would ask that you look not only at large businesses, small businesses, but micro businesses. How do we engage micro businesses? What role do they play? How do we incent, you know, entrepreneurial spirit? How do we reward that spirit? How do we enhance that spirit? How do we help cultivate entrepreneurial spirit as a part of our overall economic development strategy?
Right, so for example, we pick winners and losers frequently with our tax policy in the city, and we make it part of our legislative agenda, but we should evaluate that to determine when we're seeking out either tax credits and tax support for some of our industries or others that we're not, and how we make those determinations of how we value a job in one industry versus a job in another industry, and what our commitments are for that and why we make those various commitments. And again, make sure that we're not just doing something that seems trendy or sexy or temporary, but look at the sustainability of those economies.
Okay, members, anything else? Then we will, without objection, concur with the ad hoc committee with the additional items that we've mentioned here today and a report back to this committee as we move forward. Thank you. Oh, I'm sorry. We do have one card before we complete the task. Mr. John Howland.
Thank you.
CCA in the House.
Good afternoon. I'm John Howell with the Central City Association. CCA is in general agreement with the recommendations in this report. The city needs not just a comprehensive strategy, but a bold strategy to attract businesses to invest in Los Angeles. And it must do more than just compile a list of existing programs. Businesses, especially the businesses that do not require face-to-face interactions, the businesses that typically provide good-paying, career-oriented, and career-track jobs, have choices where to locate. Whether you care to admit it or not, the city of Los Angeles and the state of California are expensive places to start and operate a business. The cost of living and the cost of regulation are both high, and this is a strike against us. A comprehensive economic development strategy must take these factors into account and find ways to help mitigate them. This must be more than a plan that tries to smooth out rough edges or round off some corners. The city needs to demonstrate to business owners and entrepreneurs that it understands the choices are available into where they locate. Creating robust programs and incentive plans or a way to demonstrate this is a first step. The next step would be to, if you'll indulge me, please. Thank you. The next step would be to offer a one-stop concierge office to help these businesses navigate the cities and the county and states' processes and requirements to open and to operate businesses or expand businesses. And this could be done through expanding the mayor's business team. When the city creates major challenges to businesses, such as a major increase in the minimum wage, it should look at the ability to pause that program, such as the state has enacted, in order to take a break if economic conditions mandate it. This is yet another signal to business that the city understands their situations. Just as a good business must invest to grow, the city needs to invest to bring new businesses here. The report is a good start on identifying how the city can and must plan to create this investment. Targeted tax cuts for filming and for the auto dealerships are just two incentive packages that have more than paid for themselves and brought jobs and business into the city. These are the kind of strategic yet bold thinking the city needs to do more of. And you can also complete the stalled hotel incentive ordinance that's been languishing since 2009. CCA has made suggestions on major and minor policies to help in this area, and we look forward to continuing to work with this committee, the Ad Hoc Jobs Committee, EWDD, the Planning Department, and the Mayor's Office to help bring about more growth in the city. But with any strategy, it must be more than a document. There must be steps taken to help implement those suggestions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your very thoughtful comments. All right, members, if there's no other business before us, this meeting is adjourned.